Welcome to the Wrocław Jug. Today our guest is Mario Fusco. I'm happy that you agreed to our invitation. Thanks for coming. Everyone who watched the stream on the YouTube, you can ask questions, and those of you who will be active, you can have a chance to win a JetBrains license for the IntelliJ. During the presentation, I will interrupt Mario and ask your questions. So ask them, and I hope you will enjoy. Mario, stage is yours.
Thanks a lot, Sebastian. So, hi guys, thanks a lot for having me. My name is Mario Fusco. I'm from Italy, and I work for Red Hat. I'm the project lead of Drools, that is the role engine of Red Hat. I'm also the coordinator of the Java user group here in Milano, and a frequent speaker, now forced to be a remote speaker like everybody else. Today, I want to talk to you about a few ideas, design pattern on how to design a Java API. I guess everybody knows what an API is. An API is a communication protocol between two pieces of software, the consumer of the API and the provider of the API. So it's basically two things that has to communicate together. And if you don't put the piece together in the right way, you can end up in situations like this. An API is something that you as a Java developer normally consume to achieve some tasks. So you have an API to, I don't know, book a flight or check your the tweet for a given search for a given query or whatever you want. You have API basically for everything, as you know. An API is just a contract between the consumer of the API and the provider of the API itself. And why should I care about this? Because in general, yes, 90, it really depends on the kind of job that you do, but in 99, I guess, percent of cases, you are the consumer of an external API. Well, unless you are not, you don't work for a company that makes their own framework, but in general, you are a consumer of API. But at some point, you will also end up providing an API, writing an API for your customer, for your user, for people that will have to consume it. Okay, and it is really important that your API is nice to use. Otherwise, people will not enjoy using it. That's all. And there are a lot of basic principles to follow to create a nice API. I try to list some of them here. If you look at them, there's a bunch of stuff, and some of them are also, let's say, somewhat in contradiction. And this means that creating a nice API, it's also a balancing effort. It is a trade-off. You have to look for instance, the nice balance between finding the right level of abstraction on a side, but don't have leaky abstraction, but also give to your user enough power, enough primitives to achieve the task they want to achieve. So just to list this principle, they are very general. An API has to be intuitive, easy, understandable. It has to be learnable and discoverable, meaning that you shouldn't be forced to read the documentation. You can probably discover the method of a class just by using the auto-completion of your IDE. But this doesn't mean that it shouldn't be documented. Documentation is a key part of a nice API. It has to be easy to use, minimal, idiomatic. It has to use properly the feature of the language in which is written. As I said, it has to have the right level of abstraction and use correctly the time system. It has to have a limited number of entry points, or otherwise your user will feel lost. An important thing, you should respect the principle of least astonishment. Your user shouldn't be astonished, surprised by the behavior of your API. And this is something that I will clarify after with a practical example. In essence, like all software, basically, an API is not something written in stone. Is something that needs to evolve. So other than all those basic principles that I listed before, it's also important to keep in mind that your API sooner or later will have to change. Will have to face a small and big changes and improvement. This doesn't mean that your API should be general, should be confusing, use and return random map as in this joke, just for future extensibility. But you have to keep in mind that it will change sooner or later. And the first principle to follow to make your API easier possible to maintain and to change is that you should keep it minimal. You should add something to your API, not just because it's something that it is easy to develop, to provide now. It is not a good enough reason. Because yes, it could be a 2 hours effort now today to add this feature that seems to be useful, so why not? But that feature will have to be maintained, and will have to live together all other feature of your software, all other feature of your API, and that thing that looks harmless today could be an obstacle, a limit for the future maintenance and to rightly evolve your API in future. Okay, so these were really 10,000 meters overview of the principle, but I really wanted to show you this principle with very practical example with simple code. So yeah, I spoke about documentation. This is the very first topic of my presentation. So first of all, it's really important to write a meaningful Java doc. Often the Java doc, for instance, for setter and getter looks like this. They don't have two. And also a very simple setter, for instance, could have a meaningful documentation if you think about it. So yes, you are setting a value, but in your Java doc, you can say what are the admitted value, what will happen if you try to pass a value that is out of range, and also you can say other thing. For instance, if that setter or the entire class is supposed to be trade safe or not. So there is a lot to say also in getter and setter. And documentation is really important because if you don't write it, you are leaving to your users a lot of guesswork. They will have to guess what will happen if I use this class from multiple, if I use an instance of this class from multiple threads at the same time. What is the meaning of this method? Why these two methods seems to do the same thing? What is the actual difference between the two? So if you don't document your API, you will leave your users with lots of question marks. So this was about documentation. It is very important, but still it is also important that your API is easy discoverable and learnable without reading it. So let's look at the tricks that you can put in your code to achieve this. First of all, one suggestion is, overloading is nice, useful, but quite often we abuse of it. For instance, in Java, we are forced to sometimes in Java for the primitive types, for instance, so you have to repeat the same signature, the same method name, but passing different kind of object of or primitive type. I have a very evident example here in the native string builder of the Java API. Sometimes you are forced to do lots of overloads, for instance, because of primitive, but sometimes probably all these overloads are just too much. For instance, also in this case, why do we need a different method for a string and for a char sequence, provided that a string is also a char sequence? And really, why do we need also it for a generic object? I mean, probably just one for an object that calls two string on that object should have been enough. So, sometimes are forced to use overloads. Sometimes we abuse of it. Okay. So overloads is a way of providing a convenience method. And I have another example here. This is a made-up API intended to allow your user to place a stock order. So in this API, in this example, I have a method to sell a stock and three different methods to buy a stock because the price in my domain model, the price could be fixed or could be defined by a range and couldn't have a commission. So I defined this API following by domain model, following my business requirements. But what I'm doing wrong here? In my opinion, I'm doing wrong a few things. First of all, it is a business needs, but probably I have too many overloads of this buy method. There's a better way to do this. Another thing that I'm doing wrong here is that I have an inconsistent argument order. If you look in the sell and buy method, I have an inverted order for price and quantity. This is inconsistent and is error prone, and it will confuse your user. Another mistake that I'm possibly doing here is that I have a long list of arguments. Even worse, in this case, they are arguments of the same type. So it's very easy for the user to do a mistake and for instance, invert the minimum and the maximum price. How can I do better? Okay, I should leverage encapsulation here. So in this domain model, the price, it's a complex entity. It's not just a number. It can be a number and stop. It can be a range. It can have a commission or can have taxes applied to it. So it's a complex quantity. I have to model this thing with a proper object. And by doing so, I'm able to remove all the overload, because all the nuance of the price, all the different possibility that I have to define a price is encapsulated in the price object itself. Again, I don't know if there are questions, but feel free to interrupt me. So I decided to define a price. How will let user to define this price? My suggestion here is, in your API, where possible, don't allow user to use constructors directly, but provide them with the static factory method. The advantage of static factory method versus Java constructor is that you have a nicer syntax. Okay, this is probably just at the dates, but in this way, your user won't have to use the new keyword. But the more important is that in this way, you can return different subclasses. If you are calling the constructor of the price object, you are forced to return a price object. If you are calling a static factory method, you can return different subclasses with different behavior, as I'm doing here. Or you can also do a check of the precondition and return a special instance of the price interface that models the fact that you are breaking some precondition, for instance. Another thing that I like is using Fluent API. The difference with this is that, again, this is nicer for an user point of view, because in one case you have to create a price and then you have to set the different argument, and then you have to also put this price into a variable to do so, and then you can finally use the price in the by method. If you have a Fluent API, you can fluently invoke method on this object and modify in place the price, or also return a new, also have immutable have immutability and return a different instance of the price with the commission set and with the fact that this price is a gross price. And you can write this fluently in a single statement and use directly the result of that statement directly in the by method this time, instead of having to assign it to an external variable. One of the nicest example and richest example of Fluent API in the Java ecosystem is, of course, the stream class that has been introduced with the Lambda expression with Java 8. So with the stream class, you fluently define a set of what are called intermediate operation with the stream class, and then you have one single terminal operation that produces the result. So you have a Fluent API to define all the operation that you want to apply to the stream, plus a terminal operation that describes the result that you want to achieve. So this is a very nice example of a Fluent API in Java. And a different note on this stream class is that if you look, you have this drop while and take while method. This method do exactly the same thing of the limit and skip method, but limit and skip works on a fixed value, while drop while and take while work on a predicate. But except for that, they do exactly the same thing. So limits the stream to a specific size, take while limits the stream using a predicate, but they do the same thing. So I believe there is a naming consistency here. I believe it would have been better to call that method limit while instead of take while, because these two methods does exactly the same thing and should use the same verb to underline the fact that they are the same. So again, choose the name of your method carefully. Okay, another suggestion on a different topic is that it is important to rightly choose the argument that you use in your API, not only the argument, but even also the return type. Why is this important? Because the applicability of your of the specific method of this API. Let me give you a practical example. I'm creating this concatenate method. Is there any question? Yes.
From okay. Tomasz, there's a question about a slide before. Mario, wasn't this dictated by the fact that those two are idioms in functional programming, drop while and take while?
Yes. The fact is that present in the original stream version introduced with Java 8. So they have a sort of an after thought, but still, I believe that these are an inconsistencies with this name. Yes, it is the standard name for functional programming, but if you think about it, there are other examples functional programming dictates that have been ignored by the Java API designer. The first example that comes me to mind is with completable future. The completable future is a monad, sorry for the bad word. So it should have two methods that are named map and flat map. If you look, those methods are called, I don't remember the name, but something like then apply to compose to completable future. And if you look at the signature of the method, if you want to follow the functional programming idiomatic word, that method should be called flat map. But they call it then apply, because it was more, this is also questionable, but in that case, they used to ignore the functional paradigm because it was more closer to the domain model of what a future does. And so probably, yeah, this is another source of inconsistency. They followed the functional dictates for the stream API that didn't do for the completable future. And yeah, I don't know why. So I don't have an answer. I mean, in this case, there is not the thing that is totally correct or totally wrong. I'm just saying that there is probably an inconsistency here, but this is my opinion. Okay, did I answer the question, I hope?
Let's hope so. Yes, Tomasz said that yes, and he thanks. And it's just this one question, so yeah.
Okay. I was speaking about the types in the signature of your API. Here I'm creating this concatenate method that takes an array list of string because I want to produce the concatenation of them. But in reality, I care of the implementation of this method? Should it be an array list? Why a linked list is not good as well? So I can relax this constraint by transforming this just in a list. But do I care of the order of this list? In this method, I don't. So could be a collection. And do I care of the size of this thing? I don't. It shouldn't have any specific size. So I also don't need to know the size. I mean, so it doesn't have to be a collection as well. It could be an iterable. So you see what I'm doing here. I'm relaxing the type using the weakest possible type that does the job for me. The weakest possible type that is meaningful both for me and for the user. And by doing so, I'm widening the applicability of this stuff, because if I just have a list, I cannot pass a set to this method. Then there is no reason why. So yeah, use the weakest possible type in order to widen and in order to enlarge the applicability of your API. A similar suggestion for a slightly different reason applies also for the return type. I have another example here. I have a person and I want to return the list of all the addresses where the sibling of that person live. Okay. So I have this very simple method, but in reality, it doesn't have to be a list, because the order of these addresses is not really meaningful for your user. And moreover, very likely I may want to avoid the repetition, because yeah, very likely two siblings will live at the same address, but I don't want to repetition in this list. And how can I achieve this? Well, the solution would be, of course, easy. I could replace the list with a set and I'm done. Of course, if I do this now, the problem is that this code will not compile. And if I change now the signature of my method, I will break back the backward compatibility of my user that are already invoking it, expecting to be returned with a list. So this doesn't compile. I cannot change the list for backward compatibility reason. The only thing I can do is doing an expensive copy and wrapping the items contained in the set into an array list before returning it, which is a waste of times and resources. If I thought about this problem when I designed for the first time this API, the right thing to do would have been thinking that okay, my user doesn't need this list to be ordered. There's no meaningful order between addresses. They can be just a simple collection, not a list. And by relaxing this, I will this allow me to in future change the internals of the implementation. So use the weakest possible type for the returned type, improve the evolvability of your API. Okay, so another example here. As I said, your API should be idiomatic. And lambda expression became idiomatic in Java with Java 8. And we shouldn't ignore the existence of lambda expression now. So let me clarify this with another practical example. So I have a event producer here that on which you can register a listener, and this listener has to With this listener, you can actually listen for two things, a before event and an after event. But if you give to your user the definition of a listener in this way, you are obliging your user to create an anonymous inner class in order to register a listener. Maybe you don't want to do this. So the way to do this is, okay, first of all, your user could be interested in only one of these two things, typically. And then, so if you split them in a before listener and in an after listener interface, you create two methods for register these two different kind of listener. Now these listener are functional interfaces because they only have one abstract method. And by doing so, you allow your user to define a listener with a plain lambda or with a method reference in this case. And this is much nicer for your user. Moreover, if you do so, typically you are no longer forced to define your own interfaces. In these cases, if you look at this, these two listeners are just consumer of event. So you can use the standard consumer interface provided by the Java API. Avoid to define your listener interfaces. And again, allow your user to register for this listener with just a plain lambda, not obliging them to write a verbose anonymous inner class. Okay, this is something that I know is very questionable. Somebody, well, you know, check exception is a love or hate thing. Some people love it for some reason. I hate it, really. And I edit even more now that we have method references and lambdas, because with method reference, you end up in situation like this. So you are not allowed to use a method reference here. Why? Because that write method throws a check and exception. You are forced to catch it inside the lambda, and then you are no longer able to use the exception. You are no longer used to write the method reference or a simple lambda. You have to catch the exception inside the body of the lambda, which is very ugly. And in reality, if you look at the code that developers typically write, you will see that that forcing people to catch an exception is almost never a good idea, because they almost never do a meaningful thing in the catch block. Sometimes, yeah, probably logging a statement is the most meaningful thing that you can do, but still you are not dealing with the error. You are not doing something about the error. Even worse, you can print a stack trace. You can simply ignore it and put an empty catch block there. What I typically do is rewrapping the checked exception into a runtime one, into an unchecked one, and redrawing it. This is what I typically do. Or you can write a a message on the system out, but it's not really meaningful. You are just making the compiler happy, but you are not doing any meaningful job in average in that catch block. So this is why I don't like it. Okay, different topic. Still feel free to interrupt me if you have any remark about checked exception.
Well, there is a request to share the statistic which you show in the later, for maybe in Twitter or something like that?
Yeah, well, you can download the all the slides from my SlideShare account. So if you go on SlideShare, you can see and download the PDF of this presentation together with all other my slide decks.
And what is the source of this data?
I took this on Stack Overflow survey.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, yeah, different topic here. This is about what I called making your user to deal with the right level of abstraction. Okay, let me make another practical example. I have this method that takes the name of a file, reads the file into a byte array and returns to byte array. Okay, what am I doing wrong here? Of course, I have a leak. I'm forgetting to close my file input stream. So if I don't do, I have a leak. And if I call this method repeatedly, I will accumulate my leak, and at some point, my program will run out of file descriptor, or the operating system will run out of them. So yeah, what I have to do is every time I use such a thing, I need to close the stream. I have to remember to close the stream. Of course, yes, I can. The from Java 7, Java allows me to do this in a nicer way using the try with the resource statement. But still, this is something that I need to remember to do. Me as programmer, I know that this API has to be used in this way, and I shouldn't forget it, okay? And this is a leaky abstraction, probably. I'm forced to call, to use this API in a specific sequence and to never forget to call close on it. Probably I can do better. Let's try. So, yes, I have this problem with function that throws an IO exception, which is a checked exception. I'm creating a sort of ugly workaround here. But except for this, now I'm creating this method that is called with file, to which you pass a file name and a consumer. Okay, and the internals of the method that I'm giving you as an API provider is taking care of properly dealing with the file input stream, and is taking care of closing the always closing the input stream. So this means that if you use my method, the method provided by my API, you no longer can forget of closing your file input stream, because it's no longer up to you to close it. Okay, what is happening here is that my API is in control of the resource. It is loaning that resource to you. This is why it is called the loan pattern. That probably loan pattern probably is a more typical name in the Scala world. I borrowed it, but me as the API provider, I'm in control of the resource. I'm creating it. I loan it to you. You use it using by defining this consumer, and then the control comes back to me, and it's my responsibility to close it. In this way, you don't have any leaky abstraction at all. You can no longer have any file descriptor leak. It is no longer possible that you forget to close the stream. Okay, I don't know if there are questions about this. I will move forward otherwise. Yes?
No, there is no questions.
Okay. Another different topic. This is a rework, a simplification of something that I did in my rule engine in Druze a while ago. I was re-engineering the Druze API for a new major release, and I wanted a single point of access. So I ended up with this very huge interface with tons of methods because I wanted a single point of access. So every interaction that you had with my rule engine went through this rule engine services interface. So this provided all, this encapsulated all the services provided by my rule engine. But if by doing this, I ended up with an enormous interface with tens or hundreds of methods. And of course, it was not really readable. And the problem here is that there are lots of things that you can do with my rule engine. You can, for instance, compile a given resource and create a rule base out of that Druze resource, or add a module already containing a few rule bases, or you can send some command to the rule base to insert a new object in the session or modify it and so on, or you can register a logger. You can do a lots of things, and these are quite different area of my code. So what I did is splitting this interface in sub parts. So I still have a single point of a single entry point, which is still this rule engine services interface. But now I'm from there, you can navigate to a specific sub part of my API. So if you want to send a command to my rule engine from the rule engine service, you can get another API, another interface that gives you the possibility to send commands, to create commands for my rule engine, and you use directly and only the part deleted with the command. So by splitting these interfaces in this way, I'm both achieving the fact that I have a single entry point, and I'm splitting the responsibility of all the different feature of my rule engine in different interfaces. Okay, another suggestion is to be defensive with your data, meaning that you see I have a person, I have a list of siblings of that person, and a method returned that list. But the problem here is that I'm returning the living list, the live data of my Poggio. So if you do something on that list, you are somewhat corrupting the internal of the person. You don't want to allow your user to do that. You want your user to probably read the list, but you don't want them to modify the list in this way. So what you typically do is wrapping this list with an unmodifiable list, and returning it to your user so that we are not allowed to change it in place. And in this way, you are protecting your data and protecting the consistency of your data. Another suggestion related to this is you should never return nulls. So in this case, I'm returning a null if the person has no siblings. I'm returning a null if the person doesn't have a car. And of course, as you know, the null pointer exception is just around the corner in this way. So what I do is that, okay, If in my domain model, is it possible that a person may or may not have a car, and typically this is what happens, I want to model this information, this characteristic of my domain model with the type system. I want to say with the type system, okay, look, this a person is not forced to have a car. He may or may not have a car. So I'm not returning a car, but an optional of a car. And again, in the same way, if I, the person that doesn't have any sibling, I'm not returning a null. I'm just returning an empty list of the sibling. Different topic again, another suggestion, if possible, please avoid using Boolean argument in your API, because it's really simple to get them wrong and it's really confusing. So in this example, I have an employee contacts and I want to get the phone number of my employee. And the phone number could be the mobile number or the home number. And I want one of the two, and I'm telling to my API which one of the two I want by passing a Boolean. But then when I use this API, it's not really simple to remember if I should issue, in which case I should pass a true, in which case I should pass a false here, without reading the Java doc or the name of the variable at least. So it's very hard to get this wrong. And moreover, it may happen that at some point we may need a third value, and at that point you are really lost, because of course you can have a three valued Boolean by turning it into a Boolean object, not a primitive type, and then use the null as the third value. I've seen this a few times. It's very horrible. But what I'm suggesting is that you don't use this Boolean, but you use an enumeration, even if you have two value, because in this way, it is really obvious to use your API. You cannot get it wrong. You are not saying get phone number false, but you're saying get phone number of type home. So it's self-explained. Yes, Sebastian.
Yes, there is a question about this slide. Is a better solution to create two different methods, get mobile phone number and get phone number, or three in this example?
I'm not strongly opinionated about this. This is really up to you. It really depends on your tastes and on your use cases. So yeah, it depends. If you have two of them, probably you can add two methods. If you have three of them, maybe. If you have 10 of them, probably you don't want to have 10 methods in your class just because of them. If you have 10 methods, at that point it makes sense to have an enumeration. But if for 10 methods you have an enumeration, maybe it's better to be consistent and always use an enumeration. So this is one rationale for this, but again, it is not written in stone. It's just my opinion, and I'm not strongly opinionated about this in the case you have only two values. If you have only two value, probably you may also want to consider to duplicate the method. Okay, related to this, another thing that I see quite often is what I call the primitive obsession. So what I'm doing here, I'm creating a registry of all the phone number of my employee. What this thing is returning is a map of a list, because the first value of the outer map is the employee name, and then I have a second inner map, which has as key the employee's number type, and then it has as value the list of phone number for that given phone type for that given employee. So this is what I call the primitive exception. We are used this primitive that are map and list for everything without strongly encapsulating and give a domain name to our stuff, to our classes. So what instead you should do is that, okay, you give to your user this method that return a phone book, not a map of a map. It is a phone book. And then from this phone book, I can get the employee contacts for a given employee. And then from these employee contacts, I can read the number, the list of phone number for a specific phone type. So again, I'm avoiding this primitive obsession and creating a proper domain object to model my my business domain. Okay, I spoke a lot about optional. As you know, optional is often a long debated thing. Stuart Marx, which is one of the creator, I guess, of the optional class, call it the mother of all back shedding because, yes, it always drive to a lot of discussion. Okay, so I also experienced Java developer has a strong opinion about this thing. Of course, I have too. My opinion about this is that first of all, I spoke about the principle of the least astonishment, and I must admit that the first time I saw this class, it broke that principle for me. Why? Because my expectation was, okay, I want to use an optional to avoid bumping into a null pointer exception. And guess what? If you use the optional, if you use its most common and easier and the first static factory method, and you pass a null to it, guess what? You will get a null pointer exception. Okay, so this really broke the principle of least astonishment, at least for me. I was really surprised by this behavior. Again, because my idea is that I want to use an optional to avoid null pointer exception. And anyway, by using it, I will get a null pointer exception. Okay? So my my opinion is that this method is the wrong default. I assume it is the default constructor because it has the shorter name. It's the very first one that you think to use when you look at this class. So it has the shortest name. So I assume it as the default factory method for this class. And this default factory method has a wrong default behavior, in my opinion, which is throwing this null pointer exception. And probably I don't want to use this unnullable thing that is a bit awkward in my opinion. I mean, I want the behavior of the of nullable, and I want to call it off. Okay, so that's my point of view. If I was the designer of this class, I just added one single factory method, call it off, but with behavior of the actual of nullable method of the current optional implementation. Of course, I wrote this opinion in a blog post, but also I discussed this on Twitter a few times. And well, Twitter is probably not the best media to discuss this this kind of thing, but often I end up discussing this stuff on Twitter because I have lots of connection there and it's quick. I took a few screenshots of that conversation. My suggestion is not to read this tweet. I left there only for your own reference, but don't get distracted by them now. What I wanted to underline is that designing an API is an iterative process. So I like discussing this specific API with people because they can give me a different points of view. And then they can make me understand I can give more importance to one thing. They can weight a different use case in a different way, give more importance to something else. So it's nice to discuss this and understand others' point of view. And not only you can give different importance to different things, but there could be use cases that you weren't thinking about at the first instance. For instance, Trisha told me, look, I feel the need of both the off and of nullable method. I use them both, and I have a meaningful use case for them. And I wasn't thinking about them. I wasn't seeing that use case before Trisha made me notice. And again, yes, a good API has different characteristics, and as I said, it is a trade-off. You cannot make everybody happy. It is a balanced effort. So you have to add convenience method to your API, for instance, but not too many to confuse people, but many enough to let them make them their work in a convenient way. So again, it is a balancing act. It's a difficult trade-off, and you have to sometimes privilege one point of view or another. And another important thing is that an API can have different intent for different people. So to me, the intent, the goal of the optional class was to avoid the null pointer exception. And Tajir made me notice, look, this is not the intent, the original intent of the optional class. The original intent of the optional class is just modeling the fact that a value may or may not be there. A value may be there or may be missing. The point is not avoiding the null pointer exception, as I thought. So I assumed an intent for that API, but in reality, it was just my assumption. This is to say that designing an API is an iterative process. You have to iterate, review it multiple times, reviewing it, clearing the intention that are not totally clear, removing redundant method and duplicated code, removing leaky abstraction. In a word, you have to practice dog feeding. You have to feed to eat your own food. Otherwise, you will end up being a sliding door company with an entrance that doesn't use a sliding door, which is pretty weird. Okay, and this is what I have. Again, I understand this talk was a bit opinionated. It is based on my personal experience as a Java developer. Many may have many different opinions, but I wanted to provide my feedback based on my experience, and I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you agree with many of the things I saw I said here. But if you don't, even better, because this open a discussion, and I'm eager to hear your opinions.
Okay, so I can assume that you have a minute for some questions, sure. Right? Okay, great. So there is a question from from Tomasz. Mario, do you like object calisthenics? It's 9 rules of object programming. I just Googled it because I didn't know even that. Oh, okay. So you also.
I'm sorry, I don't know this thing, but I will look for it. Can you please?
Yeah, in the comments, I will write to you after
the name. Yeah, I haven't understood the name. I will look for it. Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay.
I don't know about it. If you have any specific thing about this that you want to comment, I just don't know the name, but they are well established principle that we can discuss anyway, even without knowing that specific naming.
Okay, so second question was from Gabriel. Why do you think those methods exist in optional class? Should be a reason for that.
I told you. I mean, for instance, Trisha said it's one of the reasons is failing fast. Okay, so. What Trisha said is that, again, I don't want to avoid null pointer exception, but if I'm passing a null to create an optional and I'm not supposed to have a null in that place, I want it to fail fast because I want that if I'm using a null there, I will get a null pointer exception. So it will my program will fail fast. I will not propagate the problem somewhere else downstream. And I see this point of view. It could be valid. I don't know. I know this API, and for my use cases, I always end up using the off-nullable method. Because normally this is what I want to do. If a value is a null, I just want an optional empty. I don't want to be thrown with a null pointer exception. But okay, this is another valid use case.
Okay, so there is a question from Artur. He asked this few minutes ago, but I didn't want you to change your context of presentation. There is a question, wide roles. Why do you use? Because you mentioned in a presentation that you are using roles.
I'm not using roles. I'm the project lead of roles.
Yes, so now you know why.
I'm the project lead of roles. This example, well, is I changed the I changed it some name. I obfuscated some name because otherwise it wasn't meaningful for people that doesn't know it. But I'm one of the maintainer of Druze. I was in a major release reviewing the public API of Druze. I bumped into this situation, and I thought it was a nice. Use cases to discuss.
Okay, so I think there is a last question. What do you prefer for error handling in API? To return results, success, failure, or exceptions, or something like that?
Well, I said I don't like checked exception. The other two possibilities are using a runtime exception instead. Instead using an either a result type that either provide the result or the error of that operation. So if you don't want to throw exception, you return this either error or result, and you are modeling in this way the fact that that method may or may not fail. And also propagating the error in this way. I like functional programming, and as a functional programming, I prefer the second option. The problem is the second option is idiomatic in languages like Scala, for instance. It's very typical, it's very common. It is not in Java. So it really also depends on your target, on your users. If your users are familiar with functional programming, I prefer to use the validation, call it as you want. In general, this is not typical for a pure Java developer. They don't expect this. They expect to be thrown an exception and eventually catch it if they want, or just propagate it. So, to recap, as a functional programming, I prefer the either. It is not idiomatic in Java.
Okay, thank you. So I think it's all. Thank you for coming. Thank you for all for those questions. I will find someone of you with IntelliJ JetBrains license. So keep checking your email or something like that. Mario, thank you for coming. I hope someday you will come to Wrocław and you will do the talk about something else or about API. Maybe something will change and we will talk in person about that and we will just sit somewhere and you know, speak together in person, everyone. So thank you
maybe,
all.
And maybe have a beer together, yes.
Yes, exactly.
I'm really eager of this, yes. Okay. So thanks for having me and have a nice evening.
Bye.
Bye, guys.